talked about it, but for the location, on 23rd of May, we'll be at the Whitney Bradley and Brown office, WBB, here in Hampton. They're at 22 Enterprise Parkway, Suite 350 in Hampton. And when I send out the invite for that, I'll send out a map so everybody knows how to get there. Okay. I know, I appreciate your patience for that. And now, really, for the reason why you're here, I'd like to introduce our guest speaker, Lieutenant General Rue. Lieutenant General William J. Rue currently serves as Vice Commander Air Combat Command. He's a graduate of the Air Force Academy and has an in-depth experience flying the F-16 in various operational locations and Operation Southern Watch and Enduring Freedom. He's a graduate of a variety of schools, some of which are Air Force Weapons School, Air Command and Staff College, Armed Forces Staff College, and the School of Advanced Military Studies. He has served on air, combined, and joint staffs during his career. During Operation Iraqi Freedom, he was director of the CAOC at Prince Sultan Air Base, Saudi Arabia. General Rue has commanded at the squadron, group, and wing levels to include the 35th Fighter Wing at Massawa and the 57th Wing at Nellis. He is a command pilot with over 4,000 hours, with 100 combat hours, in the F-16AC, the TA-38, and T-37. And I have it on good authority that General Rue is also an accomplished glider pilot and an elite racquetball player. While here at ACC, General Rue has been a champion for the warfighter and for electronic warfare enhancements, such as Readiness Project 2, ability to train in a contested electromagnetic spectrum environment, upgrades to legacy self-protection pods, and the EWICE study, which he has graciously agreed to talk to us today about. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Lieutenant General Rue.
Tron, we're here, and I know, unfortunately, he's not. He's the guy who usually tries to kill me this time of day in the racquetball court, or I try to kill him. He's a quite accomplished racquetball player as well. I'm really, really happy to be here today to talk about a subject that's been near and dear to my heart. I have spent most of my career, almost all of my career, when I was flying in F-16s. And in the mid-90s, I found myself in a squadron command position at Nellis at the Weapons School, working with Chuck Weddle there. No, actually, you were the assignment before that, but out there at the Weapons School, when the 561st Wild Weasel, the last F-4G squadron, was nearing its end of its life, and we realized that the F-16 was going to pick up that mission of the suppression of enemy air defenses, working with our EW assets. And at that point in time, in the mid-90s, when we shut down the F-4G, we as an Air Force took a large risk in electronic warfare. We had EF-111 still flying. We had a lot of EWOs. There was a robust part of our air staff that had electronic warfare. But from that time, from the fall of the Soviet Union in the mid-90s until just recently, the Air Force interest in, knowledge of, our training level readiness in electronic warfare was on a decline. What wasn't mentioned when I went to my first command at the group level was at Massawa in the 35th Wing at the Operations Group. I later went on to command at the 20th Fighter Wing, the Wild Weasels down at Shaw, and then back to Massawa. So I've been in the weasel business since the since 98, when I was, and I really got woken up to how we, not only how we trained for electronic warfare, but how important it was, particularly to today's fight. So fast forward to just the last year, when I've been here on the ACC staff, and I got approached by Dr. Fender, Janet, our chief scientist for Air Combat Command. She did a project about, 5 years ago, I think, maybe. 5 years ago. I'm sorry, I'm going to move around a lot, so if you're going to film me, you better get further away. I'm not going to stand up and go to you. So she did a project called Day Without Space. And she had this idea, like, gee, you know, we rely so much on space. You know, what if we didn't have some of that space connectivity, maybe due to an enemy taking it away from us? And she focused specifically on SATCOM and on GPS. And how would that affect the warfighter? And it did a lot of analysis, went into a fairly specific areas, and got a lot of people's attention, not only in the Air Force, but in the joint community and OSD. And it really woke people up. So this was 5 years ago, so in the 2007, 2008, 2009 timeframe, it woke people up as to our potential vulnerability. And so last year, Janet came and said, hey, General Rue, I've got an idea. We did this day without space, and I know you've talked a lot about electronic warfare. We've been doing some things out at Nellis. What if we looked at, in a broader perspective about how would we do, how are we ready to fight in a contested environment? And so what we came up with was this idea which ended up being this EWICE study, Effective Warfighting in a Contested Environment. And I'm going to talk to you about that today. I'm also going to talk about some things we're doing out at Nellis and answer any of your questions about what we're doing now in electronic warfare, specifically within Air Combat Command. So have your attention for this little video clip. It's the only movie we got, so if you're looking for movies, can't read it, I'll read it to you. Go back slide, please. Go back one more. Right. I think, Buster, you had a part in putting this together?
Yes, sir.
All right. Now, Lieutenant Colonel?
Yes, sir.
Buster Hernandez was a key participant in this EWICE study. I appreciate you being here. You're back from all, you've been flying, doing the V1 thing?
Recall, yes, sir.
Yeah, you suck. All right. No, good on you. That's good. We decided to do this study, Effective Warfighting in a Contested Environment. It was done at all classifications, as deep a classification level as we could get to at the program level. Obviously, I'm not going to go to that level here today. This would be unclassified. So it'll be we'll only talk about those areas that we're allowed to talk about. If you look at the way the slide is done, the title, you can see that multiple countries were involved, the U.S., Australia, the U.K., Canada. Those are the main players. The Navy and the Marines were involved as well. And we were able, like I said before, we were able to go to pretty deep levels, studying a topic that's been studied about before, but not in the manner that we did with this EWICE study. So Dr. Fender was the key worker on this, along with Colonel Hernandez from ACC staff, and then General Elder, and General Elder was our senior mentor and a huge participant as well, and a cast of hundreds, literally hundreds of people that I'll get to here in a second that worked on this study that's still ongoing. Okay, go forward two slides, please. One more. All right. So the problem statement. This technology that can test the electromagnetic spectrum is, it's not that terribly expensive, particularly compared to stealth, and it is proliferated around the world. We looked at, Janet likes to talk about information, or how do you, we rely on information for almost everything we do. For acquiring targets, for IDing targets, for making decisions, for situational awareness. We have information that we rely on all the time. Well, what if that information is not to be trusted? What if you're uncertain whether that information is true? Whether it's a radar scope with the tactical end in an aircraft, or back at the AOC, if you're at a, you're at a computer terminal trying to work on tomorrow or the next day's ATO, if that information you're receiving to make those decisions is not accurate, not real, or if you just don't know if it's true or not, how does that affect our ability to do warfighting, either at the tactical level or at your operational level? Clearly has huge ramifications. I divided this up mentally into four basic areas, and just because it's the way I've been thinking about it for the last couple of decades. But also as it relates to the areas that, that we have tend to become very comfortable with and that we rely on quite a bit for our warfighting. But this radar jamming is something that's been around for quite a while. You all know that most of you that did operations back in the Cold War era, you know, against the Soviet Union. That was a big part. We knew they were going to jam our radars. That was the bad news. The good news is our radars weren't incredibly capable back then. We had, you know, it was basic power be power, noise jamming, not a whole lot of techniques. Today we have more sophisticated radars, good news. Bad news is they have a lot more sophistication on the jamming side, particularly with techniques such as DRFM, digital RF memory, type jamming, wider bands of radar operations, you know, faster tweet frequencies. But radar jamming, and particularly high-level DRFM jamming, is not an exquisite defense of potential adversaries. It is standard equipment on fighters that come out of China, come out of Russia, really on just about everything. This type of jamming is going to be part of the standard equation. GPS jamming is something that is very, very proliferated around the world, and it's getting more so in both numbers and in power and in techniques of being able to deliver that GPS jamming. I read an interesting story, just a newspaper article a couple of years ago. A friend of mine that you knew I was interested in all this stuff sent me this little article about how one part of London, how they get their driver's licenses. And they basically give an address to the driver's license applicant, say, find this address, here's your map, and they take away the cell phone and the GPS. And that part of the test is just trying to get through, navigate through London, if any of you all have done that. But also trying to get some person, say particularly a young person, to be able to get from point A to point B, and the mental processes that they use to do that, where they're normally listening to their iPhone or perhaps in the car, you know, telling them when to turn right and left, that really messes with their mind a little bit. It's not so much their navigation skills; it's how do they handle that, you know, being able to drive safely without a GPS. Our airmen, our air crew. In the Air Force and the Navy, just about anyone that flies, you know, has been operating and living with GPS, you know, for the last decade or so, on standard equipment in almost everyone's airplane. You know, that you've heard the stories, and some of you have probably experienced that when you get to the target area, you try to find the target, you know, you have to move the cursors out of the way to make sure that they're actually, because they're sitting right smack dab on the target because of GPS, because we have good coordinates, and because the airplane has, you know, has those, knows where it's at, knows where the target is. The reliance on that precise navigation and timing, and I would say the over-reliance on that, what vulnerabilities does that cause for us, for our airmen, for our warfighting capabilities? Bottom right, comm and data link. And we talk on UHF, we talk on VHF, HF, SATCOM, and we rely a lot on communication. In the last decade or two, the type of wars or conflicts we've been in, the type of combat ops we've been in, we've generally had the freedom to do to communicate and to communicate accessibly to try to increase our level of situational awareness. We've talked quite freely, and you know, because we want to make sure, because mostly what we've been doing for the last decade is close air support, so a lot of communication initially between the command and control entities, whether it be the KAOC or JSTARS or AWACS, and the fighters, and then when the fighters get on scene, a lot of communication between them and the JTAC or the forward air control element that's on the ground.
and trying to make sure that they put the bomb, if they have to drop a bomb, you know, exactly on the target. So the only jamming, or the only hazards to our communication between ourselves has been jamming that we've done, trying to counter certain systems on the ground. You know, we're doing that jamming, and we have some electronic fratricide, but that's affected our ability to communicate sometimes on the radio, but it's not the Al-Qaeda or Taliban that's jamming our radios. We've got a generation or two of airmen that have they've expected these sorts of things. UHF, you know, SATCOM, in the airplane from fighters all the way back to an AOC, that expected to know exactly where they are at all times. They expected to know where the target is, and they've expected that, you know, with their radar to be able to see things at, you know, 50, 60, 80, hundreds of miles, and have a nice clear picture, nice clear data link picture. The bottom right on the data link, whether it be Link 16 or iFiddle or with the F-35, soon to be MATL, having a link picture that increases their situational awareness, that has friendlies and foes, and if it's on the link, it must be true, and if it's out there, it'll be on the link. A generation that's grown up with that kind of reliance and of assured information, both at the tactical end, in the aircraft, and at the operational end, in the KR. Now let's roll in the cyber threat. This is a picture of some Chinese folks at the Brazilian computers doing the cyber activities. And you start to say, how would life be, you know, if some of that information that you're relying on was at risk, either from being taken away or worse, that you're getting the information, but some of it has been altered and you don't know what that is. I mean, I do electronic banking online, and I, you know, do all the things you're supposed to do, but, I mean, I quite often check to see if anyone's stolen my identity, and, hey, what's this charge here? Honey, what'd you order? You know, I'm very quick to ask that question, you know. But in an air operations center, or down at a squadron level when they're doing flight planning, if you don't have that trusted information, are we ready for that threat? So this is out there today. This is not make-believe. This is stuff that exists today, stuff that's going to be continue to be modified and refined by potential adversaries. A lot of people, a lot of nations have remotely piloted aircraft, or what the press likes to call drones. Start putting some of these jammers, either from a radar perspective or a GPS perspective, up at altitude, forward in the battle space, and that is affecting a relatively low power GPS signal, or your receiver that's on the top of your airplane. You think, oh, I'm shielded from those bad jammers on the ground, but now there's RPAs amongst me that have GPS jamming. How might that affect it? All of these are things that I think are in the future. Some of these things are here today. Are we ready to deal with this problem? Slide. We've been living, this is a slide we use a lot, and it's got permissive environment, kind of like a test environment, and a highly contested environment. Some people say A2AD, the area of denial. I don't use that phrase. I don't like it for a variety of reasons. I do believe that there's a more contested places we may fly, and there's contested and permissive. And for the last couple of decades, with a few exceptions, we've been primarily operating in this permissive environment. It's not been permissive environment for the folks on the ground. Obviously, they've had a really, really hard task to do. We've been supporting them from the air with ISR, with close air support, and quite frankly, with a lot of electronic warfare in a counterinsurgency fight, which is a topic for another day, but that's a very interesting topic, how EWs has operated in this permissive environment. But when we get in this contested environment, a highly contested environment, we have a generation or two of airmen that have grown up in combat ops over here. And when I start messing with things that give them situational awareness, things that help them find the target, things that help them communicate, when we start messing with that in our exercises, in our training scenarios, really, really bad things happen. The first thing is denial. Hey, you can't do that. And then they get mad. It's sort of like that old cartoon of the guys, you know, sinking in the swamp, you know, the levels of acceptance. But this awareness that this threat is out there is the first step in trying to train, be better trained for the full range of military operations, particularly there over the right side of the slide. When we, in 2004, we sent some F-15 Eagles from Alaska to India, to an operation called Cope India. Training exercise, the Alaskan Eagles, some of you may recall, we handcuffed them a little bit for some security reasons, but quite frankly, they flew against some flankers, some modified MiG-21s, bison-like aircraft that were flown by Indians. They were Russian equipment, flown by kind of almost Western trained in tactics, Indian, very competent Indian pilots. And the Indian Air Force had some ECM systems on their Russian airplanes that were from a third country that were quite capable of Durham jamming systems. And to say that the Eagle pilots' eyes were watered would be an understatement. Even though we had cuffed them in some areas, you know, they were still surprised by what the effects of that jamming back in 2004. In 2005, I arrived at Misawa to be the commander of the 35th Fighter Wing over in Japan, and I was told, hey, you're going to get your guys ready to go back to India in 2006. So you have a year to get your wing ready for Cope India 2. And half of my wing was deployed to Southern Watch at the time, or over to Iraq, rather. And I was working with the people that were left, and we started going through some of these electronic warfare scenarios of what the jamming was doing and how could the F-16 CJ, you know, how do we counter that? And the level of knowledge in my squadrons there at Misawa, this Wild Weasel squadron, the level of knowledge of operating in that electronic warfare environment was, well, it was pathetic. It was horrible. The old guys that were in the room, guys like me and my ops group commander, guys that had grown up in the Cold War era, knew more and had trained more in electronic warfare environment than these kids that were in the wing at the time. It was quite shocking to me. We had gotten that far away from understanding about electronic warfare. So they're not bad kids. They were fighting the fight that was at hand. They just hadn't been faced with this kind of a threat before. So it's like, how do we grab them by the collar and shake them and wake them up to realize that those threats that I showed you in the previous slide are out there today, they're real, they exist, and if you're training for a contested or a highly contested environment, if that's what you're doing is going out and training for that, not for close air support, but for a real world mission or training for a mission, and you don't have an electronic warfare in the equation, in the scenario, it's actually negative training, and it's bad. It's you're going the wrong direction. So that's what kind of got me motivated back in 2005, and I've been on this tear ever since. Slide. So basically, we're all about flying, fighting, and winning, and we've got pretty much got this one down here. But we have to be able to figure out how to do this when either in the cockpit or in the chaos, a determined enemy is going to mess with our ability to use trusted information. Slide. So we are definitely out of money, and we have a tiny little bit of money left, as you all know, and now we're thinking, here's what we're thinking about. Slide. So we did this study, Effective Warfighting in Test Environment. We did it for about 6 months. It's still going on. We're doing an analytic phase right now. We looked at it from a coalition perspective. We realized that there's a philosophy, a typical airman philosophy is, if I've got a problem like this, well, you people on the ACC staff or you people up on the air staff, go buy me a widget, go buy me a missile, go buy me a better radar, buy me something to counter this threat. And we don't have the money to buy our way out of this threat. We might be able to make some purchases in some specific areas, but by and large, we have what we have right now. We have to figure out how to use it perhaps differently. We have to look at our tactics, our testing, and our training, use that perhaps differently in our training scenarios or with our tactics, and then make smart investments with the money that we have to help us be able to fight in this environment. Instead of using a bunch of people wearing nice coats and ties and their contractors that are, and I know half the room's contractors, so I'm be careful what I say, or using people that are not actively flying, we did a mixture and we did a heavy load of people wearing that actually bags or ABUs are actually doing the mission right now. And they were many of the study participants. wanted to limit the scope of this a bit. We didn't want to get into, there's double-digit SAMs and, you know, fighter capabilities and enemy missiles. We wanted to stay away from that. We want to stick with the degradations of the electromagnetic spectrum, not caused by ourselves, that we kind of fratricide ourselves when one system, you know, accidentally jams another system, but that caused by enemy actions. And we were looking basically in the cockpit and in the KI. And how are we ready for operations in a contested environment in those two areas? Looking relatively short term within the FIDEP, so the next 5 or so years. And there, what things do we be doing right now today, either in the non-material side or the material side? What are the things that we could be doing right now today to get us ready for this environment? Slide. We had 3 different panels in the study. I don't want to go into details, not too much of the panels, but I'll start at the bottom. The material panel was headed up by a guy named Randy Walden, SAF AQ, really, really smart guy, very smart in the acquisition world and the material world, and was able to look at literally hundreds and hundreds of proposals. We went to industry, we looked at all these different possible solutions to help us fight better in this environment, and then try to rack and stack of things that were the low-hanging fruit that with a little bit of money we could make an investment in some areas to make the most payback. We had a T3 panel, tactics, testing, and training. This was headed up by Jeff Loughran. Major General Loughran is the commander of the U.S. Air Force Warfare Center out at Nellis. Big brain kind of guy who's got a lot of both training and test, has access to a lot of things at the Warfare Center, and really looking at the some of the ways that we're from a T3 perspective of looking, how are we training in this environment right now? How are we training in our simulators? How are we training in our live fly scenarios? Are we actually pushing ourselves to operate in this area? If I'm a F-16 CJ Wild Weasel and I'm in my seat cap, you know, looking at the areas where the SAMs might be, but all of a sudden I can't talk on my radio because some bad enemy is jamming my ability to talk, but I still have data link. Can I execute my seed mission? Or do I get all confused and turn around and go home? Are we even training to that today down at Shaw or over at Spangdahlen or Misawa? Questions like that, the T3 panel report gone. At the very top, strategy and ops panel. At the operational level, we do a lot of war games and exercises, things like Terminal Fury out in the Pacific. We do unified engagement over in Europe and the Pacific, futures games, all sorts of different exercises and war games where we look at a potential enemy that does stuff like this to us. And it always scares us because, particularly at the operational level in the AOC, we've been operating in an environment of, you know, we have Nipper and Zipper, we have coalition, but you know, the fact that an enemy, whether it be Iraq or in Afghanistan, that they would be attacking our KOC from a cyber perspective, it really hasn't been that big of a challenge to us. I must say hasn't been a concern, because it certainly has, but hasn't been a challenge. And when we go to these war games and exercises, then we infuse a more aggressive and more capable adversary, particularly in the cyber realm, of how that might mess up not only the AOC, the air component warfighting side of the story, but how does that affect the AFOR, the Air Force Forces, the logistics, the beds, beams, and bullets of your fighting force? You're trying to manage that from an AFOR perspective, from a command and control perspective, and now you have a cyber intrusion into that. How does that mess things up in your warfighting ability when these missiles show up here and they really were supposed to show up here? Or you think you have a combat capability at this base, but it's different because your reporting is not accurate. Really, really challenges us from being able to do the warfight at the operational level, just as it does at the squadron and the tactical level. The strategy and ops panel was headed up by Lieutenant General Ted Kresge, Kmart Kresge, the Vice Commander of the Pacific, who was also, before that, was not only the Warfare Center Commander, but he also had some space command time on him as well. Very big thinker, big brain, and has done a lot at this operational level in the Pacific, looking at a potential adversary there in the Pacific. I also asked Kmart to look at some stuff we're doing down at Air University about how we're educating airmen at Air Command Staff College and SAS and at Air War College fighting in this environment, and I'll get to that at the end. All three of these panels work together realizing that, hey, there may be a material solution to something that's a challenge that's out there, but we just can't afford it because it's billions of bucks. But with a different tactic or a different training, a different way, we might be able to handle that problem or get, at least be a little bit better ready for that problem until we get the next iteration of technology. So this is the unique thing about this study, about going between these three different levels, that other studies have looked very narrowly at just material solutions. Not too many studies have looked at non-material solutions, but no study has looked across all the possible ways to try to get, to try to really effectively change the culture of our Air Force to be ready to fight in this contested environment. Slide. We had, General Elder was out at Vegas for what, 2 weeks, sir? And led the team, that, and Buster, you were out there too, trying to put all these slides together, but there were literally hundreds and hundreds of slides and ideas and suggestions trying to coalesce all the inputs from these three panels into some coherent, you know, briefing thing that we could use, not just for a briefing, but also to use to help drive acquisition strategies, to help inform how we train, and how we train not only at Nellis, but at all across the Air Force. And we broke it out into several areas, just five areas, I'm gonna go through them fairly briefly. And some of these things are in work, they're non-material solutions, and also some material solutions. Slide. C2, we've been, for command and control perspective, we have been very, since Desert Storm, where we, when the first Air Operations Center, the first time we had a CFAC, we've had a certain model of air controlling air operations. And when you combine that with some classic Air Force doctrine of centralized control and decentralized execution, and then when you have that in an environment where the enemy is not screwing with or messing with your ability to either communicate with the forward edge or to have awareness of what the forward edge is doing, what that results in is a very tightly controlled, centrally controlled air operations. And we have a lot of airmen that have grown up expecting that very, very tight level of control of basically not dropping a bomb until, you know, Mother May I says twice that you're, you know, you're allowed to do it. Whether that's from the KAOC or in a close air support, perhaps the JTAC at the forward edge. When we look at our AOCs, they're typically, they're geographic, they're fairly big, they're, they don't have a red concentric circles painted on the roof, but they might as well, from not only a kinetic perspective, but from a cyber perspective of, hey, if you want to get the air component, Achilles heel, you know, attack here. And when we do our future war games and scenarios against an adversary that's capable either of jamming and cutting SATCOM links or a cyber intrusion, that's where it affects us the most, is in the AOC. So one of the recommendations that's come out of this thing is that we have to think about command and control in the future in a contested environment perhaps differently than what we've been doing for the last 20 or so years. Still not giving up all the goodness of air power, of being able to spread it across a battlefield or focus it in an area, you know, of not giving that up. This is not Kazarine Pass, penny packeting, air power. I don't want you to start, you know, going back to your SOS days here. But of having this phrase that I put on here on purpose, centralized command, distributed control, and decentralized execution, is one that's getting a lot of mileage down at not only your university, but in our thinking as we look at how do we do command and control in a contested environment. For the centralized command, we still have a theater air component or joint air component commander that's looking across the theater for a joint force commander, but the actual control of those forces may be done differently than centrally back in the KAOC. Because we know that communication links will be challenged. You know, making sure the airmen that are out there doing these missions understand the commander's intent, understand mission type orders, and are able to execute further and further forward. Perhaps a J-STAR is working with the forward fighter elements doing kill box interdiction and not going back to the AOC for all of that type of control. That sort of thinking is something that we need to start educating in our airmen starting at the youngest levels, because quite frankly they've grown up with a certain real world application of command and control that they think is the only model for C2. The biggest thing this study suggested is that at the operational level we have to be flexible in command and control, just as we are flexible in the tactical level. The key to air power is flexibility. It's not just at the tactical level, we need to be flexible at the operational level. This picture you have up here, these are these really nice command and control trailers, these expandable things that they close down, but they can be transported in a cargo airplane, they can be expanded, they get all hooked together, and it's basically scalable command and control that can, with a SATCOM link, link back to a mother AOC and really do a good job of generating an ATO and doing a planning cycle with some planners for about 200 or 300 sorties. Those trailers are owned by the French Air Force. Picture was taken in Marmoussin Air Base in France, and this is what they use when they do operations down in Africa. I mean, we don't have those nice systems. This is what we have over here, right. This is the Air Ground Operations Wing that's in Europe. They combine the CRC, the Combat Com, the ASOG, and the couple other groups that they could combine to make a deployable, tailorable, scalable command and control system that could go forward and be able to either maybe have a JFAC forward or perhaps an ACE forward or have some sort of a staff forward that would link back to the AOC or link with a, be closer combined with a joint task force. All of this would help us enable to fight better in a uncertain, in a highly uncertain information in a highly contested environment. This is one of the suggestions that we have coming out of the study. So it's really a different way of thinking at the C2 level. How do we actually fight in this environment? Slide. The comms and data links. We'll get quite quickly to the classified realm, but you know how much we rely on our data links. There are a lot of possible technical solutions for increasing our data link reliability. Some of those are very expensive. Some of those get very, they get less useful the closer you get to some threats. And so we've looked at a whole bunch of different possible solutions for data links and better data links, and also with radios, with communication, whether it be anything from SATCOM to UHF, VHF, or HF. We looked at how do we, how might we be able to communicate better? And how might we be able to fight better when some of our communications or some of our links are cut? And I'll tell you, the first step in this, quite frankly, particularly with the younger airmen, is they're realizing that they might, those communication links might get cut, or the data link might not be real, might not be true, might be false. If you have a surveillance radar that's getting jammed, and that surveillance radar is set up to push those, the surveillance tracks that it has over its radar system, to push those tracks across a link of some kind, and that radar is getting jammed and it's pushing out false tracks. How often do our airmen, whether it be in a Super Hornet F-18 or an F-16, you know, how often do they look at their data link picture and say, those tracks are not true, they're false? And then once they realize that they may not be true, how do they react to that? So a lot of this from the communications and data link perspective is the first level of awareness of this threat is out there today. It could come at us from a variety of ways. I'm pretty sure I can talk about this. If not, we'll burn the camera. If I mentioned half-quick, you know how half-quick radios operate. It's never been, half-quick radio has never been called, never been advertised as comm jam. It's not jam-proof, it's comm jamming resistant, I think is the phrase that half-quick is always used. It's not jam-proof, it's jam-resistant. And you know how half-quick operates with references to a common unique time reference. So if I'm fighting in an area that has a heavy amount of GPS jamming, and the first inclination is, my cursors may be off or my system navigation may be off. The fact that you're having trouble talking to AWACS or your fellow people in your package on half-quick might be the result of you have different timing references. And you might actually have to go into the radio and do what we used to call a manual TOD, which now is an emergency procedure because no one knows how to do that. I'm not being facetious, because everyone's radio is automatically updated by a common timing reference. Take the timing reference out. What does that inject in the cockpit? Fog and friction. Why can't I talk? Why isn't he answering me? awareness that in a heavy GPS denied environment, this might be a problem. That's the, we have a lot of kids who are like, what? How did that happen? So we have to raise awareness and raise training. Can we do that right now today? Yes. I don't normally go to the F-22 sims. I've been there occasionally. But if I were to go to the F-22 sim that's here at Langley right now today and ask them how often do they, how do they replicate communications jamming in the F-22 sim, sim probably doesn't do a very good job of doing it. If I say, hey, can you turn the UHF off? Oh yeah, I can do that. Does that replicate a ground-based UHF jammer? Probably not perfect replication, but it replicates the effects of not being able to talk on UHF, and I might have to find another way to communicate, to do my tactical. And so a lot of our simulators, a lot of our virtual training, we don't have the absolute perfect replication of some of these threats, but we do have a way to replicate the effects of those jamming challenges. And that's what we have to do right now, today. I can't perfectly replicate a GPS jammer, but I could turn GPS off and force someone to use other systems to be able to find the target. Slide. This is what I've been talking about. This is a unclassified sniper video of some power plant. And it's not, it's, this is a, if your target for the day was the, you know, southwest corner of the southeast corner of that building there in the center, and you showed up at your target area, and lo and behold, your cursors are right there, right smack on your DMPI, that's what kids would expect. However, if I showed up there and I turned my target plot on and my cursors were up there in that dry lake bed, how would I get them back on the target if GPS had drifted by, if your navigation system had drifted by a couple miles? Or how would you react to that? How do you train for that? For those of us that grew up pre-GPS, GPS, not a big deal. For those that have grown up expecting that God has given us GPS that will always be there for us and it'll never be taken away, it's a huge deal. Slide. So I talked about, or talked around, or whatever, the effect of GPS on this slide. And then this is an unclassified Link 16 picture of data links. And if my airplane has drifted, my navigation system, my airplane has drifted 2 miles this way, and yours has drifted 2 miles this way, but we're both on the same data link, might that cause some inaccuracies in our Link 16? Or, that's enough. All right, slide. So this top thing here is, quite frankly, in an air-to-air discussion, is how for about the 15 years or so, when we started to get a lot of AMRAAM missiles and the beyond visual range fight, that's kind of where we lived in our training realm. Now we had the aggressors, the bad guys on that side, and the eagles, you know, on this side, and they'd line up, you know, 80 miles away from each other and come at and do the, what I call the dance of the sugar plum fairies, and try to see whose missile could outstick the other missile. And a really, you know, in a really hard problem, usually the eagles would go 4v8 or 4v12 in a clear comm, good GCI, no radar jamming, high AMRAAM PK fight. Very hard problem, just ridiculously unrealistic, and in my opinion, negative training. So if I add red jamming, I could give the bad guys some DERPM, and the blue guys don't have anything, that's really a really sucky fight. In my opinion, this is how it's really going to be, you know, fighting a contested environment in the future or today. We're jamming them, they're jamming us, weapons PK is low, IDs are hard. Who's going to win that fight? And it's not an area that we have gotten, up until the last couple of years, put a lot of thought into. Slide. So we made some changes here at ACC a couple of years ago, actually started about 3 years ago with General Fraser, myself, and General Goldfein getting here. And we did this, the readiness projects. And the readiness project number two was, let's shake up the CAF, the Combat Air Forces, and figure out how we're going to get them woken up to be able to fight and train in this contested environment. Quite frankly, we got a lot of pushback, a lot of resistance from a lot of youngsters who told us to go away and go back to our office and leave us alone, please. And I wanted to, I thought to change the culture, we had to have two forcing functions. We had to get the the Nellis, the head of our, the center of our tactical universe there at Nellis, our weapons school and our warfare center, we had to shake them up and get them to buy into this concept, and they did, through the leadership of now General Shags O'Shaughnessy. And he did a great job of getting the, but again with some resistance, of getting the weapons school to change their syllabi to incorporate this all the way through their syllabus. And at the other end, our IG, which I had a little more control over, our inspector generals that go out and do the ORI scenarios, the big inspections at the wing commander sphere, and we injected this philosophy in the IG scenarios. And with those two forcing functions of the weapons officers at the bottom and the IG at the top, over the last 2 years of pressure, we've been able to actually change the culture in the field. We were really used to this kind of a fight right here, but now we started getting a lot more high-level jammers on the aggressors, and that got a lot of people's attention. We did some follow-on exercises up in Alaska called Northern Edge, that with a lot of dirt from out there, that got a lot of people's attention. This SAM is actually not a real SAM. It's a one you can buy on the internet. It's a decoy SAM. And the decoys are getting the CCD, Camouflage Concealment Deception, adversaries are building a lot more decoys that also have some electronic signatures that look very much like the real thing. So we're starting to try to get people to think differently about targets. We have not only cyber aggressors that try to work in to get people to think, how do I do mission planning or how do I do operational planning with a cyber threat? We also did a cyber flag, like a red flag, only in cyber space. We've done two of those the last year. A lot more stuff with radar jamming and some things that the O part is operationally limited, which I'll go into later. This CDO, Contested Degraded Operation Limited, is really a mindset. That's what it says up there. It's really a culture change. It's getting the kids to understand, I may still have to go fight my way to the target, but I may not have GPS at the time when I need it. How do I still execute my mission? If I can't talk on the radio, but I still have my links, can I still do my mission? If I don't have my links, but I can still talk on the radio, can I still do my mission? So we incorporated into the weapons school, our IG inspections, our RAP is our Ready Air Crew program, the old GCC, if you're that old, you know, that your training table type stuff. But that, we injected into that, said thou shalt, and did some rewrites of some regs and some planning documents. We just infused this all the way through, and it's now, I'm pretty confident, it's taken hold. And now this new generation of young airmen that are going through are starting to think about training and being ready for a different type of environment. And I think we're on our way to changing the culture of the Air Force. Slide. So this is our bottom line. We're still about bringing dominant air power to the fight, but we have to realize that we've been behind the power curve in electronic warfare and the cyber threat environment. We have to shift the way we think about command and control. This electromagnetic spectrum, electronic warfare, to me, you know, the response I would typically get is, hey, sir, that's really nice, but you don't understand. We're really not flying very much. We want to get really good at this in a non-jamming environment, and then when we're good enough, we'll throw in some of this jamming stuff. And I say baloney, because this is in the fabric of the fight. This is how it's going to be. If you're training to fight against any near-peer competitor or anyone in a contested environment, this electronic warfare is going to be part of their tool set. It ought to be a part of our tool set that goes back against them, and we ought to be ready for the fight. We have to adapt smartly in a resource-constrained environment, i.e. buy the things that we can with what we can afford that has the most leverage. We have to have innovative changes in our culture and our doctrine and our acquisitions, priorities, education, training, all critical to be effective in warfighting in a contested environment. Slide. This is one quick slide on Air University. General Elder and I spent a day, well, you probably spent more than a day down there, of really looking at what do we teach our airmen at Air Command Staff College, SAS, Air War College. What do we teach them? They're there for a year. How are we preparing them today to get ready for warfare in this type of environment? I would say, and I think General Elder would agree, he spent there more time there than I have, that it's been lacking. And so we've got them energized, the leadership at Air University, to change some of their curriculum and to really take a hard look at how we're educating our future commanders about fighting in this environment. At not the tactical level, but also at the operational level. Slide. So it's my favorite electronic warfare slide. It's always my get off the stage slide, for those of you who can't see in the back of the room, the cowboys are saying to each other, hey, they're lighting their arrows, can they do that? And the answer, as all of you know, is heck yes, they can do that, and they will do that. And to have our airmen that were surprised in 2004 at Cope India, were surprised in 2009 at Northern Edge, AMRAAM PK expected, AMRAAM PK actual. The fact that we were surprised as the world's best Air Force should make us initially ashamed and embarrassed, but then we're American fighter pilots, what are we going to do about it? How's the CAF going to react to this? They can do it, they will do it, and we're going to fight our way through it and we're going to win, but we're only going to do it by changing the culture. That's the path we've been on here at ACC for the last couple years. Slide. I know I went longer than I was supposed to. I apologize. I get kind of animated. It's probably the last time I'm going to give this pitch. So I'll take questions, or y'all can break and go back to work, and I'll hang here and answer any of your questions if you want. So any group questions? Yes. I won't be upset if someone has to leave to go back to work. Sorry. Because I don't. Right?
Brad? No, sir.
All right, good.
Red Flag 13-3 just wrapped up last month. Is that going to be the premier CDO training environment?
The Dash 3 series red flags, which we've done 13, we did 12-3, we started with 11-3. For those of you familiar with red flags in Ellis, they used to be 2 weeks long. If those of you are old enough to remember the old green flags of the 80s, where it was very, very heavy in the EW environment, we took that philosophy, merged it with red flag, and made it 3 weeks long so we could actually get to some of the things that we wanted to get to, but we always ran out of time with a 2-week red flag. It's done with US, with either UK or Australia participating. So it's done. We're able to conduct the exercise at a very high level and basically bring out all the toys and bells and whistles that we can at the classification level we can. And that red flag went and got some very good lessons learned at it. The trouble with it is that since we've been doing these Dash 3, my personal opinion is we take kind of a crawl, walk, run approach, or now I think they're up to, you know, walk, run, and then run faster approach, but it's still a gradual approach to the levels of jamming, taking away radios, comm jamming, even they've done some data link jamming, and then still trying to make our way to the 70 series to drop the bomb on the industrial complex or whatever, whatever targets are out there. But my point to the warfare center and to the CAF at large is we need to be ready to do that on day one. The way we fight wars is run, walk, and then crawl, not crawl, walk, run. And so are your local training, be in the simulators or in your local CT areas where you're doing your local training, you gotta be doing this every day so that when you get out to the red flag in the first couple days and you get hit with the best that the enemy can throw at you, is that you ought to expect this jamming, you ought to expect these challenges and information, and fight your way through it, beat the defenses down, and then that's how we go to war. So I'm happy we're doing it in this Dash 3 series. We're not to where we need to be yet, just because we happen to have a red flag that gets into this. We need to be ready to fight at a higher level quicker. Personal opinion. All this is personal opinion. Sure, I'll never be quoted out of context for this. Yes, sir.
EMP, is that still a
It was outside the scope of this study. It is still a very viable problem and a concern. And there's a lot of interest right now in just how will the F-35 play in that role? And it is still a great concern. I'll kind of leave it at that. Yeah, but it was outside the scope of this particular study.
Can Clancy-type writer be working on something like this for his novel, or is there one already out?
Not me. I'm not a big writer in that regard, but I think this is a good news story. You know, and all of you have a different background in electronic warfare, and many of you have been felt bad, I think, over the maybe the last decade or so. Maybe the last 15 years, and EF-111 went away, the F-4Gs went away, EA-6 is going out of the Navy inventory, and it's like, did we forget about the importance of electronic warfare? And I want you all to know that we haven't.
And we have two COMACs in a row, Commanders of Air Combat Command, that have taken this and not just done it as a staff project, but really embraced it and figured out how to change the culture of our Air Force. And we've had discussions with the Navy. There's some areas of the Navy that are, they need to work on as well. In May 13th and 14th, 14th and 15th, there's a, in Virginia Beach, there's a joint warfighter conference that's done every year in Myrtle Beach. AFSEA and Naval Studies Institute puts it on. 2 days long of a conference open to the public, a lot of different panels. The one panel that I'm leading is about how to do effective command and control in a contested environment. I've been talking with the panel members, two Navy admirals, an Army general, and an Air Force general, and they're all talking the same story. How do we've got soldiers or sailors that are used to operating in a certain environment that's a fairly permissive environment as it comes to control, command and control, and communications. How do we get them ready to fight in a different environment? And everyone's thinking about this. I think we've let turn it, but we still have a lot of work to do. All right, I'll hang around here afterwards if you have one-on-one questions. I really appreciate the attention and time. I'm sorry I went overboard, but I appreciate what you all do for our Air Force, even as civilians. General Alder was saying he had a meeting with the chief yesterday. Spent the whole day with the chief as retired general officers, and the chief of staff was telling General Elder and his fellow retired general officers to get out there and tell the Air Force story. And this is a good news story. We have some other bad news stories on funding and budgets and sequestration and all that stuff. But this is a story that I think we're moving in the right direction as an Air Force. And we still have some work to do, but I think we're moving in the right direction. All right, thank you all very much. Appreciate it.